This is my body. This is my blood. Remember me by doing this. I'm going to the Father, but I will always be with you.
Jesus' Last Supper. This is the night before he is betrayed. It's the night of his betrayal. And then he is falsely accused. And then the next day he's crucified. And it's something that the church, we celebrate. We go back and we remember. And when I say the word celebrate, there's a reason we call it that. And we'll look at that as we go through today. We celebrate communion because he's alive. Anybody glad for that?
Yeah.
So, yeah. And he paid the price for our sins. Now, depending on your background, and I'm so glad you're joining us online as well, you may call it communion. Maybe you call it the Lord's Supper. Some of you may call it Eucharist, which is from Scripture. It literally means thanksgiving. And all are okay. It's all pointing back to the one thing that all Christian churches agree on is that this is a time, communion, when we commemorate Jesus' death, his burial, his resurrection. And then we look forward to his coming again. So as a church here alive, that's the one thing we want to focus on all the time. People have a lot of questions for me when they come to our church and say, well, what do you believe about communion? And that's the one thing we always come back to is we're all celebrating Jesus' death and resurrection. What does that look like for us? Why do we do that? I want to walk through that a little bit today. In fact, I want to take it a little further and walk through what Jesus was doing the night before he was crucified. Because he was celebrating Passover meal. Now, let me ask you a question. If you knew that tomorrow your life was going to be on trial and that you were going to be crucified, you were going to die, what would you do the evening before? Jesus celebrated Passover. Now, if that was that important for him, I want to know why and how it applies to my life. So today, I want to talk about Jesus as the sacrificial lamb. We see that in Scripture. Well, what does that mean? Now, here's my prayer for you today. My prayer is that if you're a Christian, you'll experience him in a greater way in his presence. If you're not, that for the first time, you'll see what he did for you. Here's what Jesus said. And these words bring a lot of tension in my life when I first read them. And if you're not a Christian, you're probably thinking, if you're reading through the Bible, you come across these words, you're thinking, this is really in my face, kind of disgusting when Jesus says this. But Jesus says these words about himself for us. As his believers, as his followers. He said, I tell you the truth. Let's read together. Unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you cannot have eternal life within you. Eat his flesh and drink his blood. I got to tell you, that puts me off a little bit. That's not something I read and I go, oh, yeah, I'm all in. This is great Christianity. I'm taken back by that. And that brings a tension in my life. I don't want to eat anybody's blood or eat anybody's flesh or drink their blood. So what does that mean for me? Well, Jesus really is pointing towards something that is a celebration for us. And so, again, if you're a Christian, my prayer today is that you will experience his presence and all that he's done for you in a greater way every time you take communion. And if you're not a follower of Christ, that you'd go, oh, that's what he did for me. And that you would take the step across the line of faith and see and experience Jesus as the sacrificial lamb. So what does that look like? I want to take us back to Exodus for a moment. The story, this Passover, all comes from Exodus. Jesus fulfills all of the Jewish feast. They're all pointing toward Jesus from the Old Testament. Passover is one of those. It's pointing toward Jesus. In fact, what we celebrate as communion is only one of the four cups of communion, of Passover. It's the third cup. It's what Jesus did the night before he died. And I'm going to walk you through those so you can see where our history comes from, Christians, and how we live this out. So in the Old Testament, you may have seen the movies about Moses setting God's people free. They were in slavery for 400 years in Egypt. Well, in order to be set free, God sent Moses to Pharaoh, and he said, I want you to speak to Pharaoh. His heart is hard, but here's what I'm going to do, Moses. There's going to be 10 miracles. We call them plagues. And when you, if you've seen the movie, everybody seen Charlton Heston coming down off the mountain, Moses, have you seen it? And there's newer ones. And if you've seen that, though, there are 10 plagues. We call them plagues, and rightfully so, that God sent to turn Pharaoh's heart, soften his heart, so that he would let God's people go, and they would be their own nation, and they would be able to worship him. The last plague, the 10th plague, was that the firstborn of every family, the firstborn of all your animals, would be killed. Why would he do that? God said, I want Pharaoh to know I'm God. I have the power to do that. I want him to see that. So he comes to Moses then, and he says, here's what you do, Moses, so that your people, my people, will not be affected. He says, I want you to take a lamb, the best lamb that you have. In fact, it had to be a spotless lamb. It had to be perfect. No broken bones. There's so much in there that points toward the cross that we'll get into in a few weeks. There's so much there that it had to be this perfect lamb. He said, take the blood of the lamb and sprinkle it on the doorpost of your home. And when the angel of death comes to take away the first, to kill the firstborn, the angel will pass over every home that has the blood sprinkled on the doorpost. Now, what does that mean for me today? That's a great piece of history, but what does that mean for me Monday morning? Well, here's what it means for us. When we put our faith in Jesus, we have, in essence, sprinkled the blood, his blood that was shed for us on the cross, on the doorpost of our lives. Remember, we are the temple of God. We studied that. If you missed the series at the beginning of the year, Fresh Start, I'd encourage you to go back, alivechurch.com, and you can catch it. It's all archived there. We talked about how we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. We're the dwelling place of God. So when we put our faith in him, we're putting the blood of Jesus, what he did for us on the cross, and now there's a Passover for us. The Passover for us is different than it was in the Old Testament. They were looking for Messiah to come, for Jesus to come to save them from their sins. Now he's come. Now he saves us, and he gives us a rich and satisfying life here on earth and eternal life, so that when we die, we no longer live in death as eternal judgment. Now we get to live eternally with him. We're passed over. Our sins are forgiven. Anybody glad for that? Our sins are forgiven, our guilt is removed, our shame from the past is all gone. He passes over, he's forgiven us. He looks at us as though we are as pure as the blood of Jesus. Now here's the phrase I want you to get today. Because if we can understand this, if we grab a hold of this, once you do, you understand all of Christianity. Jesus is the Passover lamb. Here's why he becomes the Passover lamb. Jesus paid a debt he did not owe. In other words, he's paying for my sin. He didn't have to pay for our sin. The price, the penalty of sin is death. If we pay that price, we live in eternal death, the sacrifice of death. In the Old Testament, they would sacrifice the lamb, and it would take away their sins. They would sacrifice other animals. Now Jesus becomes the sacrificial lamb. He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay and have life. Let's say this together. He owed a debt. I said it wrong, didn't I? He didn't owe the debt. Let's say it one more time. He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. Oh, Christian, follower of Christ, you need to see that. You need to feel that. You need to embrace that. Every time you take communion, to go, oh, I remember that Jesus paid the price for my sins. Otherwise, I'd have to pay the price. And if you're not a follower of Christ, to know that that's what we're doing. That's what Jesus meant when he said, unless you eat of my body, unless you drink of my blood. And then he gave us the symbol from Passover. Now, I want to take you through Passover just a little bit. We don't celebrate Passover anymore in the New Testament because Jesus fulfilled Passover. He's the Passover lamb. When Passover was getting ready to start in a Jewish home, as they do, and still today, they'll do the Seder. The dad, the father, he starts out by making sure with the first cup, it's called the cup of purification, the cup of sanctification, and it is to be pure, to be set apart. For us, we make that choice to be set apart, to ask Christ to forgive our sins. So the Passover hasn't started yet, but he has this, there are four cups. He takes the first one, And he had to have inspected the home to make sure it was pure. Now, Jesus is pure. It's about being in God's presence. We have to be pure to be in God's presence. And if you're like me, I'm like, I'm in trouble. Anybody else?
Yeah.
Boy, I'm like the only sinner in this place. I'm it, you know? I mean, if you have the perfect and pure to be in God's presence, I'm just telling you, I'm in trouble. Because, I mean, I have attitudes someday. I drive down I-10 and you better get out of my way. If you cut me off, you know what I'm saying? There's just all kinds of things that are sin in our life. And Jesus, but how am I going to be pure? Well, it's by the blood of Jesus. Now he sees me through his blood. So one of the things that the Father would do before he would drink this glass of wine is he would make sure there was no yeast in the home. Because yeast in Scripture is always pointing towards sin. In fact, we see it here. When it comes to the lamb as well, there could be no yeast, and there could be the lamb had to be a perfect lamb. And so the Father is looking to prepare the table for communion. John the Baptist said this, the next day John saw Jesus coming toward him, and he said, let's read it together. Look, the lamb who takes away, man, I'm doing bad today. I've done it 3 times, and I got it in my mind. I need to actually read it, okay? Let's do it one more time. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Well, why does John, when Jesus comes, point to him and say, the Lamb who takes away the sin of the world? We go back to the Father with communion. He's making sure that this is the perfect lamb. It had to be a good lamb. That's all they would eat for communion. That's part of the law. Now, John could have said, he could have used one of Jesus' New Testament titles, like, look, the King of Peace. That's one of his titles. He is the King of Peace for us, and he brought peace into this world. I'm glad for peace, aren't you? That regardless of the chaos going around me, he gives me peace. John could have said, look, there's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's one of his titles. He is the ruling, reigning King of the universe. But John didn't say that. John is preparing the way for Jesus. And when Jesus walks on the scene, as John's baptizing others, he says, look, there's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Now, the Jewish culture would have understood that. For us, you know, they never would have looked forward and thought, the disciples thought that, man, there are going to be Christian churches full of people without Jews in them. That would have never happened. They wouldn't even thinking that way. So we don't understand a lot of what's written there. And what they're saying is, what John is saying is so profound for them. He goes, oh, that's the Lamb? That's the one who's going to fulfill Passover? And we won't be taking Passover anymore. He's the Messiah who's come. So the dad, in Passover meal, he inspects and says, okay, let's make sure that the bread is pure. There's no yeast in the bread. That the Lamb is the right one. And this is about us. Now, having a relationship, one of the things the dad would do is he put it, I just find this interesting, he would take the bread that's without yeast and he would put it in the middle section of a linen cloth. There's 3 sections and it represents the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he put it in that section to represent Jesus' death. He put it in there before the Passover would ever start. And now, this is about us being set apart. That's what happens in Passover and now for us in communion. To be set apart, as I said, it means to be, it's sanctified, to be set apart. It is a picture of a bride. How many of you brides, when you got married, you wore a veil? Any brides? You're going to wear it? Say? This is one of the traditions that come from the Jewish tradition for us, which is one of the feasts that Jesus is fulfilling, the wedding feast. We are, the church becomes the bride of Christ. So when they would get engaged, ladies, here's what would happen. She, the bride, would begin wearing a veil. This is before they're married. They're just engaged. And everywhere she goes, she wears a veil so that everybody knows around her that she is set apart to be a bride for somebody else. Guys, no hitting on her. No one-liners. You know what I'm saying? This lady is set apart. So every time she goes out, she wears a veil. We're set apart. And then what he would do in the wedding, the groom, he would leave once he's gotten engaged, and he would go to his father's home. And he would build a room that was going to be their celebration room to consummate their marriage. It was the wedding home. That's where they would celebrate the feast, the wedding. And when he was there, the inspector of the building project was his dad. And that makes total sense to me, because as a young man wanting to get married, If the requirement was I had to have a bridal suite for my bride, I'm talking cardboard box. Let's go, babe. Hurry up. You know? Man, you know what I'm talking about, right? So the dad was in charge. And when the dad would say, okay, you've got it. So if the bride or the groom were asked, what's your wedding date? When are you guys getting married? They would answer, only the Father knows. Those are some very familiar words from Jesus. When are you coming back, Lord? Only the Father knows. You see, he has come, and now he said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. He's fulfilling this feast, this festival of the wedding. He says, I'm going to prepare a place for you. Well, when will you come back, Lord? Only the Father knows. And then when the Father did say, okay, it's time, he would come, the groom would come in the middle of the night and steal his bride away. That was part of the romance of the Jewish tradition of weddings. Every bride was stolen away. Doesn't that sound romantic? I mean, you know, we plan, we have thousands, you know, hundreds of people come, we spend thousands of dollars. Wouldn't it have been great to put a ladder up against the window and said, babe, let's go? How romantic is that? Well, the wedding party is already waiting for them. They go, and the marriage is consummated there, and they celebrate for 7 days. And all of that now, we can suddenly see a picture of what Jesus said our lives would be like as the bride of Christ. So we are set apart. We wear the veil now, if we're a Christian, of his love. We wear the veil of the fruit of the Spirit. That somebody would look at us and go, there's something different about you. Yeah, there is. Man, I've chosen to be set apart. For him, I'm living my life for him. Now, in Corinthians, Paul, we continue on the idea of the feast. Paul says this, get rid of all the old yeast, yeast being sin. That's what Scripture uses to point towards sin here. And he says, then you'll be like a fresh batch of dough made without sin, without yeast. Man, suddenly my life is, God's looking at me like, Jeff, you have no sin in your life. Lord, how can you look at me like that? Because he looks at me through the blood of Jesus. I put my faith in Christ. Suddenly, I'm living on a whole new level. Well, what about when you mess up? I know. I confess my sin, and he looks at me as though I'm sinless, because Jesus is sinless. Let's read the last line together. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. That is a powerful line. When we get to that line, we're like, I don't really understand it, or I'm just reading through this. No. Stop for a moment. This is why we celebrate communion. Jesus became the Passover lamb. If it weren't for Jesus, every time we sin, we would have to sacrifice an animal. My job, in my role in the Old Testament would be, that's what I would do. You'd bring the animal, I would sacrifice it. Literally, historians say that a priest, they were called the priest of the temple, that they would be wading in blood about ankle deep. Because they were sacrificing. That's all they did was sacrifice for their sins and for the sins of the people. I'm just so glad we don't have to do that anymore. I probably would not take this job. You know, I don't want that. But here we see it, man. He became the Passover lamb for us. He sacrificed himself for us. Now, Paul goes on. He says, so let's celebrate the festival with the new bread of sincerity and truth. Now, this is so powerful when you look at Passover, because if you look at Jesus' life, Jesus said things like this. He said, I'm the bread of life. And we go, oh, that's cool. What a great analogy. No. It's not just a story. See, all the way from the Old Testament, they're looking forward to this Messiah coming. And when they sit down to Passover, they have bread that is pure, without yeast. And Jesus, when he says, I'm the bread of life, they're going, oh, you're it? You're the Messiah? Yeah, I'm it. Now, there are a few things about this bread that really give us a picture of who Jesus is. In fact, this is the only portrait we really find of Christ in the New Testament. This bread is without yeast. In other words, sinless. None of us could say that about our lives. So that's one reason we take this bread. And that's part of the Passover. It has stripes on it, and you can see the stripes up here. Isaiah said this about Jesus in his coming. He said, by his stripes we are healed. Well, what stripes are we talking about? He didn't have zebra stripes or something like that. What are the stripes? We'll look at them in a few weeks. When he was falsely accused and was sentenced to death, they took a cat of ten on a whip, and it had metal in it. And we'll walk through this. And They beat him, and it would literally stripe, rip the skin of his back. And we see it being fulfilled by his stripes, by his suffering. I'm healed. I'm healed of what? Forgiveness of sin, of freedom, and I have life. Jesus said he came to give us a rich and satisfying life. Anybody in?
Yeah.
That's how I'm healed. And then the other picture of here of Jesus on this bread is the piercings. And you'll see it in the bread, the peace that you get, the piercings. Isaiah said this, he was pierced for our transgressions, for our sin. But what does that mean? Literally, when he hung on the cross, he was pierced. The nails in his hands, the nail in his feet, he's pierced for the forgiveness of our sins, the spear that went in his side. This is a portrait of Christ. And what's amazing is that as they did this, they knew they're looking for what they were looking forward to. We look back. And we're celebrating now in communion. And we go, oh, Jesus paid a debt he didn't know. He paid for my sin. I owe a debt I couldn't pay. Let's read it together again. Jesus paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. Now, some of you are at the point right now where you're saying, I'm not a Christian. And you're just kind of like the dad in the Passover. You're saying, I'm just examining this thing to see if I want to make this part of my life. Is Jesus who he says he is? Will he really forgive my sins? And I would encourage you, step across that line of faith today. Christians, you need to see, we've made the choice to be set apart as the bride of Christ. The second cup in Passover is the cup of deliverance. Now, at this point for us, we would look back and we'd say, what are we saved from? I want to tell you, I'm saved from hopelessness. That was one of the big things for me when I became a Christian. I felt like life was hopeless. I just grew up in a very dark environment. I couldn't even understand why people would want to live. As a young teenager, I'm saved from hopelessness and so many other things. So here's what the dad would do. In Passover, the dad would take, everybody would have a white plate in front of them. Everything's white for purity, for clean. And the dad, instead of drinking this glass of wine, a cup of deliverance, he would start to pour it on everybody's plate. Every plate gets 10 drops. And as he poured each drop, he would say one of the plagues that God put on Egypt when he sent Moses to set the people free from slavery. He would say things like, if you've seen the movie, frogs, gnats. And then it gets more and more serious, all the way down to the firstborn is going to be killed. This is the only solemn time in the whole celebration on Passover because all the people are sitting there and they think, oh, God, you spared us from all those things. There's a cup of deliverance. So as we take communion, that's one of the reasons we come and we say, take a moment and thank him for all that he set you free from, how he's changed your life. He paid a price he did not owe. He paid for a debt that he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. And here's a picture of what that would look like. They just poured out one at a time. And they did this at every person who was at the Passover meal. Such a reminder of what we're saved from. In Romans, Paul said this, because some of us would say, well, wait a minute, I haven't been saved. I'm a pretty good person. I'm not saved from all that much. Well, Paul said, everyone has sinned. Let's read that line together. For everyone has sinned. Everyone. You know, this is like Sinners Anonymous. We come, hi, my name's Jeff. I'm a sinner. You guys say, hey, Jeff. You know, well, I thought you're a sinner saved by grace. I am. But I don't want to forget what I've come from. And now I live in his grace and I'm forgiven. It's so, so grateful. Yet God, with his undeserved kindness, declares that we are what?
Righteous.
We're righteous. In other words, we have a right standing with God the Father. We have no sin before God the Father. How can that be? Because of Jesus. That's why our mission here at Alive is leading people to be followers of Jesus. Not of Jeff, not of the church, not of an organization. Of who?
Jesus.
Man, follow Jesus. Don't follow me. Follow him. Because he is the Passover Lamb. Follow him. He did this through Christ Jesus. Jesus sacrificed his life, shedding his blood. Now, the night before he's crucified, Jesus is celebrating this. This is pretty important stuff. That's why in the New Testament we celebrate it. And he changed things for us to where it's not a four-hour meal because he fulfilled it. Now we celebrate with the bread and the wine. Let's say it again together. Jesus paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. Boy, that sums up what Christianity is all about. If you're exploring it, you need to know. That's what it is. We're exchanging our debt. Horrible, horrible debt before God. And Jesus says, I'll take it on. Now, Jesus really wrestled with that. And next week, we're going to look in the Garden of Gethsemane. Because Jesus took the third cup. In fact, if you know Jesus' prayer in the Garden of the Gethsemane, he says this, and Steve's going to be dealing with this next week about temptation. But Jesus said, Lord, if it's at all possible, let this cup pass from me. Well, when I read through that, he's praying, and I'm going, what does that mean? But what he's saying is, let this third cup, if there's any way to do this without the third cup, let this pass from me. And the third cup is the cup of redemption. Jesus says, yeah, I see what's happening here. It's a cup of suffering. You know, to redeem something, you take a coupon in, you redeem it, somebody pays you the price for it. To redeem us, the price was life. And Jesus said, let this cup pass from me. But thankful, he said, no, not my will, Lord, but yours be done. So at this point, this is communion. And Jesus gets to this point, and he changes everything for the New Testament church. Now, he has fulfilled Passover. He's the sacrificial lamb. And now he gives us life. So we celebrate three things. Let's read them together. My forgiveness, my freedom, and my future. Anybody glad you have that? That's what we celebrate. So Jesus, he takes at that meal, he takes the bread and he breaks it. And at a Passover meal, the dad would at this point pull the bread out of the pouch, symboling Jesus' resurrection. So Jesus takes the bread and he breaks it. Takes the bread and he blessed it. He blesses it before he breaks it. And here's the blessing he would say. Now, the blessing is not written in the New Testament, and it's for a good reason. It's written to Jewish people who all knew what blessings to say. You guys say a blessing like before meal, anybody? So we do that. And I mean, if Jesus were at my house eating a meal physically, he's saying the blessing. I'm not going to say the blessing. You know what I'm saying? What would he say? Well, I want to know what Jesus said. Now, the reason it's not written is because who they're writing to, they know the blessing. Like, if I were writing to you, as Americans, most of you here are Americans that I'm talking with, and I know other places, but if I said, and then we went to a game and we sang the Star-Spangled Banner, I wouldn't write out the words of the Star-Spangled Banner. You guys know it. For the most part, you know it. Well, everybody knew the blessing, so they're not writing to us here at this point. What's the blessing? Here's what he would have said over the bread. Blessed are you, Lord our God, who brings forth bread from the earth. Now, why is that blessing so important to me and to you? I am the bread of life. Unless a kernel of wheat, Jesus said, falls to the earth and dies. And he did that for us. He becomes the bread of life. Then they would have broken the bread and they pass it to one another and they eat it. Then Jesus, he broke it into pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, take this and eat, for this is my blood. Unless you're willing to eat my body, unless you're willing to drink my blood. Oh, Lord, that's a little weird. Now he's shown us the picture of Passover and how all of that, they had Passover because God passed over them from giving them life and passed over the killing the firstborn. And now he passes over us, our sin, by his grace. Anybody glad for that? Then Jesus took the cup of wine, and he gave thanks for it. And again, I want to know what he said. So here we know what he said, because they say it in every Seder that's ever done today, the same prayer, the same blessing. Blessed are you, Lord, our God, King of the universe, creator of the fruit and the vine. This is like he's toasting his bride, which would have happened in the wedding feast as well. The groom would have toasted his bride. And another one of those traditions we carry over to ours. We have all the toast, right? We don't even know where they came from usually, but he's toasting his bride. And he says this at one point in his ministry, in John chapter 15, he says, I'm the vine, you're the branch. And he tells us to stay connected to the vine. Growing up on a farm, man, we had grapes and everything, and you don't pull the branch off and plant it hoping it'll grow. It's the vine, that's where the life's at. Our life is when we are connected. We are living this rich and satisfying life when we're connected with Jesus. I'm the vine, you're the branch. Then he took it, he took the wine, he gave it to him, and he said, each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. But what does that mean? Well, the covenant, and again, going back to the Jewish tradition, in marriage, it was a covenant marriage. A covenant can't be broken. So we don't look at marriage that way in our society. We look at more as like a contract. And if you want to break it, there's rules you go through to break it. They didn't look at marriage that way. It was a covenant. It was called a blood covenant. That covenant began back with Abraham and his son, and is fulfilled when Jesus is sacrificed on the cross with us. And that covenant is between God and man. That's what Jesus is talking about here. This confirms the covenant between God and his people. Now, because of the covenant, because God said, I'm going to spill my blood for you, to be in covenant with you. When we make a choice to follow him, we're in a covenant relationship with God the Father, where he says, you're perfect before me. I see you only through the blood of Jesus. That's the lens he looks at me from, through Jesus' blood. He says, now that covenant is fulfilled. It's poured out as a sacrifice to, let's read together, forgive the sins of many. So when I take communion, that's what I'm celebrating. And in just a moment, I want us to do that. I want to start with a prayer, and then I'm going to ask, as soon as I get done praying, I'm going to ask the ushers to pass out the bread and the wine. But I want to pray first for us. If you've never received Christ, this is your moment, and for us to prepare our hearts. Would you pray with me? Father, we are so grateful for this picture we have from Passover, and that Jesus, you celebrated this before your death and resurrection, and you fulfilled it the weekend of your death and resurrection. And so today, we are no longer looking forward to hoping Messiah will come, but we look back with grateful hearts, Jesus, that you came and that you forgive our sins. If you've never made that decision, just pray this prayer. If you've never chosen to be set apart, just say, Lord, I'm choosing today to be set apart as your bride. Would you come into my life? Would you forgive me of my sin? I ask you to remove all my guilt and shame. And as I begin this journey today, let me live out my life in relationship with you now and for eternity. Lord, as we take communion together now, I pray for all of us that you would help us to remember what we're saved from and what you did for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers, if you would.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your might be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I might be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done.
Jesus, this morning, as we take communion together, we are so grateful as we look back that you became the Passover lamb, the sacrifice for our sins. You fulfilled Passover. You You paid a debt that you did not owe. My debt. And I owed a debt that I could not pay. And today, as I take communion, Lord, I celebrate that you paid the price. Give me forgiveness, freedom, and a future and eternity with you in heaven. That night, Jesus broke the bread and he said, take, this is my body. So let's take with grateful hearts. Then Jesus took the wine. He said, this is my blood. Drink and remember. Let's drink with grateful hearts. Just take a moment right where you're at and thank him. Lord, we're so grateful. You paid a debt you did not owe. We owed a debt we could not pay. And today, we celebrate that, and we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. That's communion. That's what it's all about. Now, we don't celebrate Passover anymore because Jesus fulfilled Passover, and now, in the New Testament church, he tells us, this is what you're to do, to remember that I have fulfilled Passover for you. Eat his body. Drink his blood. Now suddenly the words that Jesus says in John start to come to life. And I go, oh, now I get it. And I choose to be a part of that life. I choose to live the life that he came to give me. And he's given us a life of purpose, a life of fulfillment, a life of freedom from sin, guilt, and shame. I'm so grateful for that. And it is a celebration. Now, there is a fourth cup in Passover. Jesus would not have picked that cup up. He didn't pick that cup up. We see it in the New Testament. It's the cup of hope. And all I want you to write here is the word complete. He has completed, fulfilled Passover. You see, for the Jewish culture up to this point in the Old Testament, they would always be looking forward. There'd be an empty seat where this cup was at. And this was the cup where they were hoping Messiah would come. And they would actually send a kid out looking at the door and down the block. And when the kid came back and says, no, we can't find Elijah or Messiah, then they would say, well, hopefully next year in Jerusalem, meaning that hopefully Jesus would come back and the Jews would all gather in Jerusalem and celebrate next year. Interesting that every Jew can go to Jerusalem right now if they want. Messiah has come. And for us, the hope is fulfilled. And here's what Jesus said about the fourth cup. He said this, mark my words. I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. What Jesus is saying is like, I've fulfilled the Passover now. And we're going to drink that cup, the cup of hope, when we're reunited as the bride of Christ, us, with him, with Jesus Christ, in my Father's house. And there's going to be a celebration. We are going to party. We are going to celebrate that we have eternal life with him in heaven. Anybody glad for that? I mean, I'm looking so forward to it. And that's why Paul says you do this, and Jesus said this, you do this, you take communion. When you take it, you remember his death, his resurrection, and that he's coming again. That's the hope we're looking forward to. Now, I want to challenge you to share your hope with others. In Easter season, this is the one time of year that your friends who don't know Christ, don't go to church, will come to church. Everybody feels like, oh, yeah, it's the thing you do on Easter. Well, there's so much more to it than that. But we want to partner with you because on that day, we're going to walk through the resurrection of Jesus and what it really means in our life, whether you're a Christian or you're just considering it, how it applies to your life. So we want to partner together that you would write on your Invest Invite. You have an Invest Invite card. Write down some names and say, these are the people I'm praying about inviting. And I want to pray over them in just a moment. You drop it in the offering bucket, and then we'll be praying with you over the next few weeks. So write those names down and say, okay, Lord, give me an opportunity. We want to share this hope that Jesus has given us. Would you pray with me? Father, as we come to the end of this talk, I pray that you would just show us the people that we can share the hope, the good news that you paid the price for our sin. We have freedom and a future of eternity with you in heaven. I pray you'd give us opportunity. I pray you'd open the door that we could share our faith and invite them, and that they would come and step across the line of faith, and their lives would be changed for all of eternity. In Jesus' name, amen.